Hello children, today we'll talk about lesson number 8, heat and temperature. This is the first part of our video. So the objectives of this video is to give you an idea on E equal mc theta and E equals ln, the latent heat and the specific heat capacity of different substances. And then we will see some practicals related to this latent heat and specific heat capacity. And finally, we will try to understand the concept of absolute temperatures, which means the temperatures measured in Kelvin and how the absolute temperature would affect the kinetic energy of substances. Actually, molecules of substances. Right. So we'll have a basic idea about the absolute temperature. So absolute temperature, the idea is based on the average kinetic energy of molecules. In other words, the average kinetic energy of molecules inside the substance only determines the temperature. And when average kinetic energy is 0 joules, we define a temperature measurement which is measured in Kelvin, and we say that temperature in Kelvin will be 0 when average kinetic energy is 0 joules. So again, we'll have an idea when in a substance the average kinetic energy of molecules is equal to 0, we call that it has an absolute temperature of 0 Kelvin. Right. So I told you that absolute temperature is measured in Kelvin. There is a small relationship between the Kelvin and the normal temperature measurements that you do, which is in Celsius. There's a relationship. Now when they make this Kelvin scale, they wanted to have a specific zero. That's why they said that word absolute zero. And they mentioned that absolute zero is the place where the molecules would have zero kinetic energy. So we have a good start there. Celsius is not like that. It is having vast area. So the minimum temperature that any substance can obtain is 0 Kelvin, because there cannot be any negative kinetic energies. But as they want to, as the scientists want to have a good link between Kelvin and Celsius, what they did was they made sure that the gap between 1 Kelvin change and gap between 1 Celsius change to be the same. Because of that one, if I change the temperature by 1 Kelvin, that means the substance will also change the temperature by 1 Celsius. So there is an important part there for you to remember. What is that? When we measure a change in temperature, if it is in Kelvin or Celsius, it doesn't matter, it would have the same value. The reason is Kelvin scale and Celsius scale have identical gaps. Right. How to convert Celsius to Kelvin? Now, if you are told that you have 0 Celsius, how would you find it in Kelvin? Just add 273. For any Celsius reading, add 273. So you would get Kelvin. For an example, let's say 20 Celsius. At 273, it gives us 293 Kelvin. Okay, how would you convert? This is of course very rarely being asked, because we always want to convert Celsius to Kelvin. We rarely convert Kelvin to Celsius, because the standard unit of temperature is Kelvin. But however, we learn What is the conversion we need to do to convert a Kelvin temperature to Celsius? Let's say 300 Kelvin. How would you find it in Celsius? Subtract 273. 293 Kelvin. How would you convert it in Celsius? Subtract 273, which is only 20 Celsius. So 20 Celsius equals 293 Kelvin, or in other words, 293 Kelvin means 20 Celsius. Right. Now, a little bit of an experiment. How would you calibrate a thermistor in a potential divider circuit as a thermostat? This is kind of an experiment that you want to do. So in this experiment, you will be using a fixed resistor, and I used a 30 volt supply, that is your wish, but we don't use big potential differences as it is hazardous. And I used a thermistor, but I fixed the voltmeter in parallel to the fixed resistor. Now I will remind you a little bit of a story that you learned in AS. That is, you can remember, if the temperature increases, thermistor is made up of semiconducting materials, so there will be more free mobile electrons. Because of that one, resistance of the thermistor will reduce. We call it to have a negative temperature coefficient. Again, I'll tell. When we increase the temperature of a thermistor, as it is made up of a semiconducting material, there will be more free mobile electrons, so resistance of the thermistor will reduce. If the resistance of the thermistor reduces, you know that in a potential divider circuit, potential difference between the thermistor will also reduce. But however, potential difference is shared. Now, if the thermistor's potential difference reduces, fixed resistor's potential difference must increase. For an example, let's say at the beginning, out of this 30 volt, thermistor had 20 volts and fixed resistor had rest of the 10 volts. Right? Thermistor had 20 volts, fixed resistor had only 10 volts. Now, if I increase the temperature, thermistor's resistance would go down, so potential difference across the thermistor would go down. Suppose now it is like 10 volts. If it is 10 volts, what would be the potential difference across the fixed resistor? That must be 20, because total must be 30. So now you realize that when temperature increases, potential difference across the thermistor decreases, inversely related, but potential difference across the resistor will increase. So temperature and potential difference across the resistor in this particular circuit is directly related. That's why I have put the voltmeter in parallel to the fixed resistor, because it's easy to always go for a direct relationship. Right. So you can see the readings that we would get when we fix. So what we are going to do is, we will have a thermometer also. We'll start with ice. We'll have a thermometer. After supplying some amount of thermal energy using a heater, a thermistor is also placed inside. This thermistor will be placed inside. We will be measuring the voltage values. That is the potential difference across the fixed resistor. For different temperatures, and I will note down, for different temperatures, what would be the potential difference I got. After noting down them, I will plot a graph of temperature against potential difference. Now you can see that the graph that I have obtained. Now I drew the smooth curve by considering the points that I have observed from the experiment. Now this is the process of calibration now done. So now what you have to do is, we will take this entire circuit to a particular place where you want to measure the temperature. You won't be getting the temperature, but you will be getting a voltmeter reading. So let's say voltmeter reading is 15.4, right? Or let's say 15, somewhere like 16. That means now the potential difference is 16. We can draw a graph for the we can draw a line for the graph at 16 PD, and we can find when it is 16 what would be the temperature. So likewise we can calculate. That is the idea. So I hope you had a idea about calibrating the thermistor. Right, we'll move on to the next part. Now we are going to talk about the specific heat capacity of a substance. Specific heat capacity of a substance is the amount of energy that a substance requires. What is that? The amount of energy a substance would require to increase its temperature by 1 Kelvin. If we use 1 kilogram of substance. So we are using 1 kilogram of substance, we need to increase its temperature by 1 Kelvin. How much of energy do we need to supply? That is what is meant by specific heat capacity. Right, so with that idea, we have a very nice equation, which is delta E, the energy change, is equal to mass of the substance, specific heat capacity of the substance, and delta theta. Delta theta means the change in temperature. Change in energy equals mass times specific heat capacity of a substance times change in temperature. You know, in real life, when we provide thermal energy, substances increases its temperature. When we get down thermal, when we get down energy from a substance, the temperature of the substance reduces. So we'll see a small calculation. Now this tells that carbon is there, which is 1.03 kilogram. Milk is there, and the milk cools down from 22.5 Celsius to 3.5 Celsius. Time period is also given, 115 minutes. Calculate the average rate at which energy is transferred from the milk as it cools down. Okay, specific heat capacity is also given. They are giving us the temperature in Celsius. Final temperature and initial temperature is known, so we can calculate the change in temperature. But it is in Celsius, doesn't matter. Why? Because in this video at the beginning we learned that even though we take Celsius change or Kelvin change, it is the same. So the difference between 22.5 and 3.5 will be the same change in temperature even if we do it in Kelvin. Right. Now the equation is equal mc theta. But they ask about rate at which energy is transferred. So we'll use not a small change in this equation. I'll put over t for both the sides. So it gives me what? Rate of change in energy equals mc delta theta over time. Right. So we'll see. E. 1.03. And specific heat capacity is 3930. Change in temperature, see Kelvin. Don't hesitate to put Kelvin. We can put Kelvin because change in temperature is the same. So we found E, as I told you earlier, E over T would give me power. So this is the energy, energy divided by the time, but remember to convert time to seconds. So this is a very simple question, but carry good marks for the exam. Again, I'll tell you, we use the mass, we use the specific heat capacity, we use the change in temperature, we get the energy, we divide the energy by time to find the rate of energy transfer, which is power. So as we divide the energy, even the energy answer will be divided by the time. So we go. Okay, now we'll try to find the specific heat capacity of an aluminium block, a solid material. What we do is, we start the experiment few Celsius below the room temperature, because in that situation, from the room, thermal energy may transfer to the substance, and we finish the experiment few temperature, few amounts of Celsius or Kelvin above the room temperature, because at that moment, from the substance, thermal energy will be transferred to the surrounding. Because of that one, we can understand that there is no overall transfer of thermal energy to the surrounding. That is something that we do to increase the accuracy of this experiment. Then we measure the current and the potential difference. Why? Think. That is because we want to find the energy. You know that energy is equal to IVT. So we want to find voltage, current and time, so we will also additionally use a stopwatch. So after we supply a particular voltage for a particular time, we switch off the circuit. After switching off, we wait for a moment for the thermistor to show us the, for the thermometer to show us the highest temperature. Then only we can say that it has reached a thermal equilibrium. Right? We just don't switch off and measure the time, measure the temperature. We wait for a moment until the thermometer would show us the highest temperature. And we measure the mass of the block, all the things that are required for our E equal MC delta theta equation. And now we'll see some things that we can do to increase the preciseness or accuracy of this experiment. We have to insulate the block to prevent thermal energy transfer to the surrounding. We have to put some oil into the holes to help put thermal contact between the heater and the thermometer. So after doing everything, we assume that there's no all the thermal energy supplied to the heater is given to the solid itself. Right. And finally, we calculate the energy by multiplying voltage, current and time, as I told you earlier. And we plot a graph of delta theta against T. Right. After plotting that graph, we can rearrange our equation and get the idea that specific heat capacity can be found by the equation current measured from ammeter multiplied by voltage measured from voltmeter divided by mass of the substance and wavelength of the graph of delta theta against time. So we would get our specific heat capacity. Right, we'll move on to the next part, latent heat. Latent heat is actually related to the change of state. You know that water, liquid water can become vapor. So during that time, some energy is required. We need to supply some energy for liquid water to become vapor. So that amount of energy that we require to completely convert 1 kilogram of substance into its other form is known as latent heat. For an example, a total of 30 334,000 joules of energy is required to melt 1 kilogram of ice at 0 Celsius. That means ice is also at 0 Celsius. When we supply 334,000 joules of energy to 1 kilogram of ice, which is at 0 Celsius, it fully gets converted into water. That is the idea. Liquid. Right. Or else at 0 Celsius, liquid water has 334,000 joules per kilogram more energy than ice at the same temperature. That's why when we put it in a refrigerator, so when we put water in a refrigerator, what happens? Thermal energy from water is absorbed to the surrounding. So it loses 334,000 joules of energy for each kilogram of water and becomes ice. Right. So we call that process we call latent heat of fusion. Right. Now we see an example of that one is chocolate. You can see that temperature is reducing. This is melted chocolate. Sorry, this is solid chocolate. Solid chocolate, we are cooling it and we are right. Now we see an example. This is about chocolate. And we will cool the chocolate, melted chocolate. When we cool melted chocolate, there is a moment where we see that even though we cool furthermore, temperature doesn't reduce. Then we can recognize that is the place where the melted chocolate becomes solid chocolate. Right, at here, all the melted chocolate got converted into solid chocolate. Then what happens? Again, the temperature of solid chocolate reduces. So at this process, energy is given out from chocolate, but temperature doesn't reduce. Right, that is the idea. Okay. Now we saw a small graph, now we will see a question. In this question, it is talking about some water is being vaporized in a kettle. The mass of water that is being vaporized is 136 grams. We have converted into kilograms. And this happens in 125 seconds. Very useful, because they are asking, calculate the rate of transfer of thermal energy to the surrounding. Bit of a tricky question. So first of all, we can't find the rate of thermal energy transfer to the surrounding directly. We will find what is the rate of thermal energy transfer to water to make it vapor. Then we will subtract it from the power of heat. Right. So we will find now. We will use the equation E equals L delta M. But I will do a small change. As earlier, I will use E over T equals L delta M over T. So this is that equation. E over delta T is equal to L delta M over T. L is 2.26 into 10 to the power 6. And the mass is converted to kilogram divided by time. It would give us that this much, that means 2460 watts of power is used to vaporize. Heater provides 2800 watts. So the rate of thermal energy transfer to the surrounding is heater provides 2800, but it on vaporization only uses 2460. So the overall transfer of thermal energy to the surrounding is 2800 watts minus 2460 watts, which is 340 watts. Right, so we learned about the absolute temperature, absolute zero, conversion of Kelvin to Celsius, specific heat capacity and specific latent heat, and we did some examples of them also. I hope all of you understood about everything. So thank you. If you have any problems, you can always ask me.